Abecedarian requiring further examination of Anglican seraphim subjugation of a wild Indian reservation. Angels don't come to the reservation. Bats, maybe, or owls, boxy mottled things. Coyotes, too. They all mean the same thing, death. And death eats angels, I guess, because I haven't seen an angel fly through this valley ever. Gabriel? Never heard of him. Know a guy named Gabe, though. He came through here one powwow and stayed. Typical Indian. Sure he had wings, jailbird that he was. He flies around in stolen cars. Wherever he stops, kids grow like gourds from women's bellies. Like I said, no Indian I've ever heard of has ever been or seen an angel. Maybe in a Christmas pageant or something. Nazarene Church holds one every December, organized by Pastor John's wife. It's no wonder Pastor John's son is the angel. Everyone knows angels are white. Quit bothering with angels, I say. They're no good for Indians. Remember what happened last time some white god came floating across the ocean? Truth is, there may be angels, but if there are angels up there, living on clouds or sitting on thrones across the sea, wearing velvet robes and golden rings, drinking whiskey from silver cups, we're better off if they stay rich and fat and ugly and exactly where they are, in their own distant heavens. You better hope you never see angels on the res. If you do, they'll be marching you off to Zion or Oklahoma, or some other hell they've mapped out for us. Reservation Mary. Mary Lambert was born at the Indian Hospital on the res. She never missed a three-pointer in the first 13 years of her life. She started smoking pot in seventh grade, still never missed a three-pointer, but eventually missed most of her freshman classes and finally dropped out of high school. A year or so later, a smooth-faced Mojave who had a jump shot smoother than a silver can of commodity shortening and soared for rebounds like he was made of red-tailed hawk feathers visited her res for a money tournament. His team won the money and he won MVI. Most Valuable Indian. Afterward, at the little bar on the corner of Indian Route 1, where the only people not allowed to drink were dialysis patients, he told Mary she was his favorite, his first string, that he dropped all those buckets for her. He spent his entire cut of the tournament winnings on her wild turkey and cokes, told her he was going to stay the night with her, even though it was already morning when they stumbled from the bar. He stayed and stayed and stayed, then left. Her heart felt pierced with spears and arrows, and her belly swelled, round as an August melon. That was a lifetime ago. Now she's 17. She kept the baby and the weight and sells famous fry bread and breakfast burritos at tribal entities on paydays. Tortillas round and chewy as communion wafers, embracing Kamad cheese and government potatoes, delivered in tinfoil from the trunk of an old brown Buick with a cracked windshield and a pair of baby Jordan shoes hanging from the rearview mirror. Her sleeping brown baby tied tightly into a cradle board in the back seat. Just the other day, at a party on First Beach, someone asked if she still had that three-point touch, if she wished she still played ball. And she answered that she wished a lot of things. But what she wished for most at that minute was that she could turn the entire Colorado River into E&J Ripple. She went on a beer run instead. And as she made her way over the bumpy back roads along the river, that smooth-faced baby in the back seat cried out for something.